they did look very good. They're playing much better as a team. And you know, I did mention that Leon Black and Reiser did play a good game, but you also mentioned that Slicks had an amazing comeback. And
I
mentioned too, just where the hell did he get his farm? He just bounced back from nowhere, and that's what Slicks does best. But well played overall by TT Esports.
Yeah, it really was. So, but game number two has begun. The blind bans, in fact, taking place. So let's go ahead and jump right into it. TT Esports on the Legion side, FYKU on the Hellborn side. Of course, this is game number two again with TT Esports currently up 1-0. So the blind pan's coming out right here. So last game, remember we had Pebbles and Tundra banned by both teams in the blind ban phase, resulting in only two bans initially. This time around, we got Monkey King Jerizaya coming out from TT Esports, and then Jerizaya Keeper of the Forest coming out from FYKU. So very interesting, actually. You know, the Jerizaya both happened to ban that, but Monkey King and then Keeper of the Forest. I mean, so what do you make of the blind bans?
Jerizaya, I don't even know if he went banned last game. I don't remember. Maybe you recall, but yeah, that's a hero that I definitely think is a strong hero to ban. Monkey King also banned from Slicks yet again. No, you're right. They banned Tundra and Pebbles both last game, and he did end up banning Monkey King, I believe, in the regular banning phase, but he went ahead and banned that. And then Keeper of the Forest ban. Yeah, I think that's just a testament to how strong Reiser played that. Reiser's a very, very good Keeper player, by the way, and they don't want to deal with that yet again. Now the locks have begun, and Slicks goes ahead and locked that Valkyrie. That's kind of a signature hero from TT Esports in general. They love to play their Valkyrie. And now both Tundra and Pebbles now locked from FYKU, so that's very interesting.
That sure is. Again, the first game, both teams blind banning Tundra and Pebbles. And now here we are in game number two, and both of those heroes happen to be in the lock pool because of FYKU. And that does bring up the interesting, you know, the logic that we've talked about in the past where, you know, this is where it could actually be pretty powerful as the Hellborn team. Because, sure, you are giving TT Esports, of course, one of those two heroes in Tundra Pebbles, but you're going to get one of the other ones, so it's whichever one they don't choose. And, you know, either one you could definitely revolve around as far as the strategy goes. So, you know, I can see why, what the logic, of course, is there from our Hellborn team. Now, the response from TT Esports, you mentioned the Valkyrie, the first lock for them. Of course, you know, WTF, Leon Black, Slicks, I mean, they all love playing Valkyrie. So kind of that signature hero, as you put it. Bubbles and Rhapsody to follow it up. And then Shadowblade. Back to Shadowblade over there once again. Locked by FYKU.
I can't remember. I think they also locked Shadowblade.
It was them last game, yeah.
Yeah, interesting. I would love to see that hero play. That would be a lot of fun to watch. Rhapsody there. I mean, you mentioned you'd love to see Rhapsody. And that hero is a... He's very strong. I mean, he's kind of a weak laner, but you know, if you can get some good positioning with that ultimate, she can be devastating in turning fights. So that would be fun to watch as well. Bubbles, no question. They're a very, very strong suicide hero, probably one of the best. And, you know, they have a lot of good players. WTF plays a fantastic Bubbles, one of the best I've seen. And so no surprise there. Dark Lady now banned right away there from Slicks. Silhouette to follow, leaving that Mage Bane as one of those, well, I want to say now four hard carries. With Draconis, we saw just how strong Draconis can be played in yesterday's matchup. Now following with the Armadon ban from Slicks. One of those annoying tanky heroes that just really, really hard to deal with. Don't blame him. Nymphora banning out here from FYKU. Very, very strong hero in his own regard. Especially now, well, it's kind of funny because he locked both Tundra and Pebbles, but now bans Nymphora. They're thinking, well, I don't know. Maybe they're thinking TT Esports will pick Pebbles because they love to pick Pebbles. Slicks plays a great Pebbles. And maybe they're thinking they can take Tundra off of them if they do decide to take Pebbles out of that lock pool.
Yeah, that is a good point. I mean, but at the same time, you know, you still have your Aluna, your Glacius, who haven't been banned just yet with one more ban to go here. Of course, Tempest, the follow-up ban from TT Esports, so we'll see how FYKU decides to finish this off. Another thing to keep in mind, and there we go with the Mage being banned. So, well, big thing to keep up here, again, you look at that pool, and you do got Valkyrie, you do got Shadowblade, definitely have some carry potential, but you know, maybe not classified as that hard carry, so you talked about Draconis is out there. But what do you think about this as Moraxis? This is actually the first pick by TT Esports there. Draconis, he is a newer hero on the scene, so we have seen him be dominated by several teams now. Do you think teams that may not have practiced him yet should still look to pick him up, even if you haven't even played him?
Yes, I do. I mean, that hero, as we saw, just farms so strong, has such strong laning presence. And it also, at this point in the metagame, it can still throw a lot of teams off. You know, I think teams are slowly starting to pick up on how powerful he is, but I don't think they've really kind of fully realized that. And, yeah, I definitely think Teams that haven't really practiced him can still pick him up. He's not the most difficult hero to play by any means. He kind of plays himself. he really does. I mean, he's very, very strong. He farms so just mindlessly. Very, very strong. But, yeah, the Maraxxus first pick by Slicks. Maraxxus is a very, very strong strong hero in his own regard, but there's also very, very strong supports that are available that are not locked, being Silhouette and Glacius, especially with Nephorabin.
Aluna.
Or, sorry, yeah. I don't know why.
Silhouette, the great support.
Yeah. Why don't people run them as a support? I'm curious. No. Yeah, Aluna and Glacius unbanned. So they do go with the Poliwag Priest. Interested to see if they actually run that as a support again. As I said, it can work, but honestly, he really thrives there in that middle lane, you know, getting that fast level 6 and having those wards. And we might see a full-on push strategy now with that Poliwag, now with the Ophelia picked up from FYKU.
Yeah, you know, there is you could argue that maybe there's a little bit of a risk doing that in the sense that now you have two picks here on TT Esports, and you are showing your cards a little bit with Poliwag, Priest, and Ophelia. Very aggressive push over there. So, and sure enough, you know, you got your Luna, great clearing potential, and you got Wretched Egg on top of that. As well, could be a decent counter pusher. You know, not necessarily to sit here and say that's why they chose those heroes by any means, but, you know, it is something to keep in mind at the very least. But Aluna, Wretched Egg to follow up from TT Esports.
Yeah, I'm really curious why they didn't choose Glacius over Aluna. Hmm. Glacius is, again, like I said, and look, Glacius Falk. Interesting all chat coming out from Scizor. But
oops.
They can't even pick two heroes at this one time. So.
Well, maybe he's saying they'll get Valk in the lock pool. Figuring that TT Esports won't take her. We want those too, so. Oops. Or some mind games going on. Who knows?
Yeah. I don't know. But I definitely would have picked up Glacius if I was a Slicks there. And actually, Glacius goes to FYKU, and I think that's a very, very strong decision there.
So why Glacius why Glacius over Luna, though?
Well, it's a great counter to Ophelia.
Okay.
You know, you Ice Imprisonment those creeps, and they're there for quite some time. I think it's actually double the amount of time that it's supposed to be on regular heroes.
Yeah.
Don't quote me on that. But the basic idea is that it freezes them for a long time and kind of prevents some easy early Ophelia ganks there. So I definitely would have picked up Ophelia. Also, Glacius now for FYKU, it's a very, very good hero against Wretched Hag. Because you max out that if you do decide to level up the Ice Imprisonment, it's very good against a blinking hero like Hag, who does have that escape mechanism with Blink, but is also very susceptible to ganks because of her, you know, not so tanky nature.
I think Pebbles Valk here is like perfect, actually. Pebbles Valk or Pebbles Bubbles even is perfect here for FYKU. So yeah, of course Tundra with the first pick, and not surprising in that sense, but. That's a strong lock pool, and it is going to give a lot of options here for FYKU, but like I'm saying, I think that Pebbles has to start with him. You got your Pebbles Glacius lane, Ophelia Jungle, Poliwag Priest solo, and then you throw a Bubbles or Valkyrie on top of that as the other solo. You definitely have accomplished quite the strong lineup over there on the Hellborn side. So we'll see if they go with that. Sure enough, there's the Pebbles, and there's the Valkyrie. So, yeah.
Yeah, Valkyrie is very strong. I like Valkyrie as having some sort of late-game potential on your team. Valkyrie, we've seen, taken to the late game, just dishes out so much damage. I actually still would have liked to see Bubbles a little bit over Valkyrie. Now, that kind of has no late game in it,
it's
but
be Rhapsody,
this is a very push-heavy, aggressive team coming out from Team FYKU. So, and you think this is going to be a Rhapsody coming out?
Well, because I'm thinking it's going to be tri-lane. Aluna, Rhapsody, more access even, because what else can they do? I mean, are they going to lane a Wretched Egg Tundra with somebody else? I mean,
yeah, no,
it doesn't make sense. So.
Yeah, you're right. It probably will be a Rhapsody. So,
or a support Shadowblade. There's always that.
he does have a ranged attack if you decide to go E, yeah. And they do it with a Bubbles, so.
Support Bubbles?
Yeah. I don't know. That's very interesting. I'm not quite sure.
That is really interesting, yeah. They had a chance. They had a great chance to pick up Rhapsody. It made sense, and they screwed up. I'm lost. I mean, I don't know what. What's going on? I really am at a loss for words.
I think it is going to be a support Bubbles.
Huh. I've never seen.
I don't really see anything else that they can do, like a Bubbles. They might even do dual lanes here. I'm not quite sure. I don't know. That's kind of an awkward lineup there from TT Esports, but I'm sure they'll make it work. Slick seems to usually make it work somehow. But
true.
But I definitely think the Hellborn side has a little bit of a stronger lineup there. Their lanes are very, very strong. They have a jungler. They have lots of push, lots of aggression. And it's just a matter of how they lane this. I think for sure we're going to see this Glacius and this Pebbles lane together. That's really one of the strongest lanes in the game. Actually, Pebbles walking bottom along with Glacius. Probably an aggressive tri-lane here coming out from Glacius, Pebbles, and then the pseudo tri-lane with that Ophelia with some assistance. Polywog mid, Valkyrie top. That's going to fare out very well against the lanes that are actually being set up by TD Esports, which is a pseudo tri-lane top. With that Bubbles, as you mentioned, so poor Bubbles. Never seen this before, at least in this context. And then the Tundra mid being played by White there, and then the Hag solo bottom in the short lane. So I definitely think that FYKU has the better lane set up here.
Mm-hmm. Well, like I was saying, you know, again, when we went into that lock pool stage, it was pretty obvious what they're going to pick, and it, as a result of that, it just made so much sense with the lanes and just the power of their lineup. So, yeah, FYKU, like I said, I really wouldn't be surprised to see them take a game at the very least off against TD Sports here. They are down 1-0, and not to bring up history, but right after I say that, I'm going to go ahead and bring up history. they played Vitriolic their last match, and they lost the first game. Epic 70-minute battle, as we said. They came back in game two, and they won it about 20-25 minutes, I believe it was. So, again, this is also a team that's showing that they can even come back after being in deficit against some of the better teams out there. So we'll see what FYKU can do this time around. But now this Bubbles, I mean, like you said as well, I mean, you never really seen it yourself, either have Vi. Theory crafting a little bit. I mean, is there potential for a Bubbles to be a good support? I mean, I don't see him as, because we talked about the Poliwag Priest, of course, there is, but Bubbles doesn't seem like one that's the greatest support.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's okay in like a dual lane. It's not so much chat going on. I'm just getting so bashful. No, but yeah, I don't know. Bubbles is one of those heroes that he could do okay. I mean, it's not the end of the world, but I think this tri-lane is going to kind of be futile here. Like, against a Valkyrie, that's exactly what you want if you're Valkyrie. You want to be going against three heroes because you have that good escape mechanism. And I think that FYKU knew that something like that was going to happen. Good pull there by Bubbles. Although this could be actually kind of bad for them. This could give some Valkyrie good position here in this lane, or at least a little bit of a decent farm. That's kind of an awkward pull right there, if I do say so. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if I agree really.
Middle lane, real quickly, Skeleton King coming in. Nope, not going to get there in time. Tundra is able to be found. But yeah, so yeah, you're talking about the pull-up here. Sucks is going to farm it. But so not the most effective pull, though, you think?
Well, it was just kind of awkward. I mean,
okay.
Yeah, I think they're better off just standing there, putting some aggression onto Valkyrie instead of pulling that and maybe risking the fact that, you know, the Hellborn creeps go there as well, which they did, but it's not the end of the world. They're doing some good pressure there. Valkyrie's going to have a hard time this lane. But at the bottom lane, at the same time, Hag, he's doing a really, really good job of keeping this lane under control and keeping it close to his tower. Hopefully, you can do some massive denying at half HP creeps from Pebbles and Glacius. But right now, you see, now the Soldier is going to die for him. He's going to keep this lane right where he wants for Hag. So really, really good job by WTF. He's doing really well down here. He's 5-2 creep score. And right now, actually, see the double archer right here? Well, it's actually double warlock. Actually, some aggression coming out onto the Polywog mid. He goes ahead and grips him with assistance from Ophelia, but I don't think they're going to have enough damage due to him because Tundra's just a beast and has so much HP. He's coming close there, but he will be fine.
Oh, Polywog nearly down to the creeps, actually. Need to be careful right there. He got very low, but is able to come out on top. Now, Bubbles is actually roaming in the middle lane. If he got here just a little bit earlier, maybe been able to pick off. The piercing shards are going to hit Polywog Priest, but no Bubbles follow-up. He does have a Shell Surf ability at level 1, which he just at level 2 right there. But again, knowing that it's not going to be enough damage, not really worth using the mana. So the roaming Bubble strategy has begun here from TT Esports, and Riser, of course, playing the Bubbles. But yeah, that was very close. But now, Ophelia, we have talked about this before. She does go the Q ability in the Nature's Wrath, at least level 1. Used it right there on a Tundra. Maybe tried to amplify enough damage to get the kill, but as we saw, wasn't nearly enough. You like seeing it here, or would you rather still see that Judgment ability?
I think it's fine. I think it's just fine. The only reason I really like getting the Judgment spell is by the time you level up a little bit, you're able to use that port effectively. That's the main reason, really, why I like that spell. Now, I keep looking at this bottom lane. It's just kind of poor lane control coming out from the Hellborn team. I mean, Hag is getting more experience because it's getting pushed to him. And he's doing really well down here. He's 11-3. And if you're in this lane, you need to shut this Hag down completely. And that tells me what's happening in this lane is that Glacius was actually harassing too much in the beginning. And what happens when you do that is actually pull the creeps, and it ends up pushing the lane in the other team's favor. Mm-hmm. And so the best thing to do early on levels, and actually a gank attempt coming out from Ophelia in the top here.
Yeah, going to try to go set up a gank onto Aluna. You see the Q comes out. There's the Vagabond Leader nuke, but not nearly enough damage. And Leon Black will just activate the health potion. Should be more than fine. In fact, a turnaround going to happen on Valkyrie. There's a power throw on top of the Quake Stun. And the final auto attack from Moraxis picks up the kill. Now the Vagabond again, another nuke is going to meet up for the kill on that Moraxis. No, it is not. He is still over here using some regen, though, with the health potion and the mana potion. And he will end up surviving. Meanwhile, the middle lane, Bubbles and Tundra doing a big dive right there beyond the first tower. They take out Shizor, playing that Poliwag Priest, so a couple of big kills happening here for TT Esports all of a sudden.
Yeah, really good job. I mean, this roaming bubble seems to work out somehow. Ryzer doing a good job with assistance there, or assisting Tundra there in the mid lane. Tundra doing a fantastic job. I mean, as he should, this is why Tundra is god tier. I mean, the hero has everything going for him. I won't even go into that as I have before in great depth. Mm-hmm. But this bottom lane is just not working out for them, and actually they both... Do they both run all the way back to get reach? I don't understand. This Hag is going to be level 6 by the time they're level 4.
Yeah.
Oh, this is just not going well for them at all in the bottom lane. And actually, I'm actually really wondering why Ophelia is in their jungle. One of the common things you do when you have an Ophelia and you're going up against one hero is you actually don't want to ward the pull, because you can use that aggressive pull to your advantage by diving the bottom tower and actually getting an early push or a kill on them. So I feel like Ophelia should actually be in the enemy team jungle and applying some pressure to this Hag, but it's a little too late right now.
Yeah, so this is definitely your example of they have strong lanes, as we stressed, but maybe not executing it the greatest. Whether that's positioning, like you said, the Ophelia being in her own jungle. She's going to get pressured a lot here by Bubbles, actually. There's a shelter port, the final auto attack, and the dumpster taunt on top of that. Oh my god, Ryzer picks up a free kill onto Ophelia. It is just falling apart here. For FYKU, it's a 3-0 hero kill advantage. The bottom lane, you mentioned WTF on Wretched Hag. She's got to be getting close to level 6. She's farming crazy well for ping in a 1-2 situation. And then you got Poliwag Priest, by the way, in the middle lane. And I wanted to get your thoughts on this real quick. Look at Poliwag, 13-3 creep farm against a 31-7 Tundra. He's been dominating this whole time. I mean, is that expected?
I mean, you had a little bit of harass and rum coming out from Bubbles, but... Yeah, I mean, I think so. Tundra, in my opinion, really does beat Poli quite handily. And actually, Poli's going to go down very easily to this tri-gank here. Such an easy kill right there. And actually, Ophelia might be in some trouble here as well. Totally misses the Ministar stun, and she's definitely going to go down, but not before Tundra dies as well. Actually, Tundra dies after that. But still, a good kill there from Ophelia, I guess. But I don't know. It doesn't really work out in their favor, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know what Ophelia was thinking, honestly. And I get the idea of trying to get a counter kill, obviously, out of Tundra. But it was a 3-1. I mean, obviously, you know that. You saw the shelter for Bubbles. You saw Wretched Hag initiate in the first place. Was it really worth that dive? And she died first, so didn't even get the experience for it. So, yeah, pretty big deal. Meanwhile, at the top lane, Bad Blast being used on Valkyrie. Gets the lead point. The power throw hits, though. And the final auto attack from WTF. TT Esports is really clicking on all cylinders right now. You could just really see it in the way this game is being played right here, that the emotions are high on the side of the Legion team, and it's definitely working. And this is the TT Esports team that we know and love here, and at least the Hong competitive scene. When it comes down to them, there's a well-oiled machine, you know, playing together, very, very good aggression, and getting an early lead and then working off of that. They have a 6-1 hero kill advantage. You see Tundra, he's going to fall back as Bubbles as well. There's a lot of pressure coming in. He gets the stomp off. Not in time, though. There's a Q, the final auto attack. Not enough, and Bubbles stays alive. Now trying to turn on a counter kill, actually. Polymer Priest awards come down, but not enough with the Tungsten. You see the Avalanche being used. Oh, the tower switches at the last second, though. And it will not kill Poliwag Priest. Now the Minotaur putting in some auto attacks, but Tundra is going to be more than fine. How did nobody die here? In the middle lane is completely beyond me. But everyone stays alive, and oh, by the way, in the top lane, Moraxis is like, I'm going to push this lane, no big deal. 421 gold per minute already for Slix there.
Oof. Yeah, that was actually really funny. Poliwag changed the target of the wards to the tower, getting that aggression, or the aggro from the tower onto the wards rather than the hero. So that was really, really well played. I don't know if he did that on purpose. I think you kind of have to actually, you know, physically switch the target.
Yeah.
Or maybe Tundra just kind of ran away and it did it on its own, but... I'm going to go ahead and give him the benefit of the doubt and say that was a fantastic play there by Poli, but, you know, unfortunately, this whole Hellborn side is really struggling, and I really think it goes down to the bottom lane. I mean, Ophelia should have been there 100%, especially when you put, you know, all your eggs in the basket of Pebbles in the long lane. Let's say they decided to switch up the lanes, or if they even guessed the lanes incorrectly, and they were facing, you know, some sort of a dual lane between Aluna and Moraxis here. They would have been crushed. They would have definitely needed that assistance from Ophelia. I think he should have just started there, or she should have started there to begin with. and helped out this lane. But, you know, they had no lane control in the bottom lane, and a Hag by WTF did such a great job. And, you know, obviously Slick's doing a wonderful job himself. He's almost got that portal key, I'm assuming. Well, he's got the Steam Boots and another 700 gold, but he is, yeah, farming out of his mind with that early tower push. And everything's just looking so well for TTE Sports at this point.
Yeah, you got your pebbles. I mean, he has 1,000 gold saved up. He does have his Steam Boots, but... So we'll see if he just goes now straight for that portal key from here on out, maybe figuring even that they're behind by so much, he needs to get that as soon as possible. Poliwag Priest in the middle lane gets obliterated right there. Just a four-man gank out coming. The Bat Blast going to be used as well for Metronek in the final auto attack to finish off Glacius right there. As FYKU again, not just nothing's working for them. It literally just, if it wasn't already, Olan, a lot of commitment to Pebbles, make sure he just gets the most farm. It even more so is now. I mean, they need this Pebbles portal key to be the most impactful thing ever in any Han game. It pretty much seems like at this point, because again, TTE Esports, they're playing so well as a team right now. Everything is coming together. You got Moraxis, who actually, he in fact picked up a Beast Heart. I mean, he's not even worried about getting that portal key himself as soon as possible. He's going to build a little bit differently. But it's just a very, very aggressive team, and on all levels. You pull up the gold per minute chart, it's a beautiful gold per minute chart for them. You got 400 Moraxis, you got in the 300s for Tundra and Wretched Dagger, and then Bubbles, who's been support, 210 gold per minute, and then you got a Luna. Rounding it up at 180, all of them higher than everyone else but that Pebbles there on the Hellborn team. So it's, I mean, I think it's pretty obvious, but for FYKU, it's just as simple as get that portal key and hope for the best.
Yeah, I guess at this point that's really all they can hope for. I mean, you just look at WTF's been involved in half of the kills, 4 out of 8, and he's farming just really, really well. You can imagine he wouldn't have been able to participate in any of those kills and roam around had he not got those fast levels. And so it directly impacts how the rest of the game goes. You can't just sit around and be like, well, Pebbles is farming really well in the bottom lane, but Hag's getting a little bit more experience than she should. I mean, that's a huge deal. You need to shut down that lane, and they did none of that. You know, but you have to put some credit on also to WTF. He did a really good job of controlling that lane. Mm-hmm. And he's wanted to say, I don't know if he's been playing more Han lately, but regardless, he's still a great player. Even if he's not, and you know, he's just a fantastic player, one of my favorite players to watch.
Yeah.
But he's doing a really great job this game. Lots of roaming around. Actually, I mean, all the players are playing very well this series, it seems like, from TTE Sports.
Oh, like I said, I mean, yeah, especially this game, we are seeing that TTE Sports team that we know that they can be, you know, as far as, you know, being that top tier team, and arguably one of the best teams out there in Holland right now. So they are making a strong statement again going into the series. As we had Riser on in the pregame, he made the point, as we were both making, that this is such a huge matchup because, shockingly enough, if they were to lose here to FYKU, there'd be a good chance that they wouldn't even be moving on to the quarterfinal stage, which is, you know, you think TTE Esports, that should be pretty much guaranteed, but it's not. You know, you need to play the games, you need to win the game. So they lost to Vitriol like early on in the very first match of the group stages, caught them off guard perhaps a little bit. Here they are, though, against FYKU, their next really big opponent here in the group, and it's they're making quite the statement here. 12 minutes in, already an 8-1 hero kill advantage, 8,200 gold lead, 1,500 experience lead, massively pushing this bottom lane. You got Pebbles, 1,900 gold saved up. It's just like it's slowly happening. He's getting closer and closer to that portal key. But in the meantime, a secondary tower is very likely going to fall. Now, they do counter push the middle first tower, but this bottom secondary tower, it is going down, and they're not going to do anything to stop this. They are counter-pushing as well the top lane, so a bit of counter-pushing from both teams going on here, but the two towers go down, and that goal lead stays around the same as a result here for our Legion team. I believe the big items now being picked up, even or at least initial items. You got Helm of the Black Legion finished on Moraxis. You got a Luna. This is a support Luna, and she's sitting here at Steam Boots, Grave Locket, and Power Supply already. I mean,
yeah.
That's ridiculous. So
yeah, they're farming very, very well all across the board. Now Pebbles does have his portal key. This is kind of like the last hope, really, for FYKU, and if they're gonna salvage anything in this game, it's gonna have to be right now. They're kind of grouping up in the mid, but the good shell surf there from Riser as they're gonna spot the possible gank, and he actually might have spotted the fact that Pebbles had his portal key now. So you know, they can play accordingly, play a little bit more conservatively. But this is also when, you know, again Tundra comes into play. I mean, this is again, this hero is so strong, and this is why I always talk about, I can't believe when heroes don't have the opportunity to first pick him when they don't pick him. Because that shiver is going to just provide so much information as far as what's going on, what ganks are occurring, what items have they bought, and things like that. And so, you know, he has a shiver up here. This is pretty much where all the Hellborn heroes are as well, except for Polly in the mid. But, yeah, they just got everything going for them for TTE Sports right now. And Slicks does go for that early tankiness or tanky nature with the Helm of the Black Legion pickup. And I imagine he's going to march on up here, and they can fight pretty easily now. There's really nothing that Hellborn can do. They have to get pickoffs. They can't fight team fights. They have to get pickoffs with Pebbles.
Oh, and here we go. The initiation with the Avalanche Tundra. He just got the plug. There goes a Shell Seraph nuke right there with the Song of the Seafront Bubbles. Picks up two kills right there. Pebbles in the front lines. He tried to combo. Not nearly enough for a kill, though. Probably a Priestess Ward's down, but it is just ugly all sorts of levels here for FYK. The power throw snipes through two. Double tap coming out. And there's the hat trick for WTF on top of that. So, honestly, if this was 15 minutes, I really wouldn't be surprised. FYK is like, this isn't happening, guys, because it is just all sorts of ugly. And it's unfortunate because, again, this is a team that definitely did very well against Vitriolic, a 3-1 record coming into this match, as we keep stressing. And very impressive. And, you know, even despite this match, to bring out the point that, you know, what happens here, obviously, again, this is one of the best teams in the world here in TT Esports. So, sure, it's probably not going to end as you were hoping for, even, let alone not even close, but as you already see, G2 ball plays even being called. Again, I'm not surprised. It's just, it's not happening. But at the very least, this FYKU team, again, it's not 100% mathematically over, but pending on some crazy losses now for really TT Esports and Vitriolic, it's probably, it's very likely that as a result of this, FYKU is going to fall just short of advancing on, as it is official now, as you can see. But At the same point, again, the point I'm trying to make here is that you hope that they stay in the scene at the very least. You know, don't let this get to them too much. The fact that they even got here in the first place and did and were as successful as they were here in the group stages is really something to be very, very proud of here in the Dream On Summer Championship. So, and a team that I look forward to seeing more of, honestly, down the line.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that first game, honestly, they were looking really, really strong.
Yeah.
They had everything going for them. While the lane setup was kind of weird with a Poliwag Pharaoh, it didn't matter. They played well. Mageblade played fantastically in the bottom lane. And you even said yourself, the turning point of that game, and I mentioned that game because I really think the morale kind of stuck with them after losing that first game. And unfortunately, they really didn't play like they did the first game and the second game. But that turning point really was they could have easily traded towers where one hero was doing the same exact thing that five heroes were doing for TT Esports.
Yeah.
And you mentioned it, and that's exactly what they should have done. But for some reason, they felt like they needed to defend that. And it did not work out for them at all. It was just the wrong decision, and it really turned the tide of that game. And up to that point, though, they looked amazingly strong, and I definitely thought that they were going to take it, honestly. But, unfortunately, they made the wrong decision, but I'm sure they learned a lot from it.
Exactly. That's where this whole sense of, you know what, they are a newer team. I mean, sure, it's great that they got as much success as they did, but they are still a newer team. That doesn't change. You got to go through those bumps in the road. You know, teams don't start, even Fnatic. They didn't start with even you guys in Trademark Esports in your history. You can vouch for this. You don't start from the beginning. It's like you're winning everything. That just doesn't happen.
Right.
You have to start somewhere. So for FYKU, you know, some learning experiences, and, you know, you hope that they take that. You know, as we saw, as you mentioned that first game, that big turning point there, the series against Vitriolic, you know, against TT Esports. Learn from your mistakes, you know, get that experience under your belt, and look forward to the next event that is coming for you. Now, on that note, I mean, it isn't over for them. Again, they still have at least they still have a couple more matches to play now. As on that note, let me just check real quickly. They're set to play both. So we got FYKU. They play MUFC actually next match, and that's a chance for them to still again prove themselves. MUFC is a very, very tough matchup in themselves. They're right now at a 2-2 record. They're both losses, of course, to Vitriolic and TT Esports as well. So the two teams can kind of share something in that sense.
Right.
And then the following week, you know, play Call It Karma. Again, another team that we've been talking a little bit about as far as up and coming themselves. So still some matches to make some points. And if anything, you know, get more experience under your belt. And again, it isn't 100% mathematically over. So at the very least, you know, win out, see what happens. Maybe the Han gods are on your side. Maybe not, though. So we'll see how that goes. But definitely wish them the best of luck with that. On that note, I believe, actually, we are now joined by Riser once again. Going to be coming back to talk to us about the match. Riser, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hey, how's it going, buddy? So big victory for you guys again. Take it 2-0. What, did it go as expected, or?
Not really. I didn't think it would be, well, I don't want to say this, but I didn't think it'd be that easy, because it's pretty easy. So,
yeah.
Didn't go as expected.
Yeah, that is where I was leaning to. I was curious, you know, whether or not it was as easy even as we saw right there. But yeah, especially that second game, I mean, they had a powerful lineup, but...
Next level roaming bubbles.
Exactly. Yeah. You guys with your next level roaming bubbles, which you, I believe, were even playing. So. What was that about? I mean, you had the chance to pick up Rhapsody, which we thought you were going to go with, but all of a sudden you picked Bubbles. Was there a reason for that, or was it just, let's try something new? Or
I don't know. I wasn't really paying attention during the draft, and I got back, and Trent said, support Bubbles, and then Leon got a Luna readied up before I could get a Luna, so I just got stuck with support Bubbles.
Nice.
I don't know why.
To say the least, you did do fairly well with it. It actually was pretty impressive to watch, so congratulations on that end at least, and you know, maybe we'll see some more now. I don't know. It did go very well. Probably not, though. Okay, so here you guys are now at a 4-1 record, of course, up there with Vitriolic, and again, it's not guaranteed, but there is a fairly good chance now that you guys will be moving on to the quarterfinals. I mean, what does that feel like for you guys now, like knowing that there is a very good chance that we're going to be moving on here?
It's good, but we need to practice more if we want to compete with all the teams that are advancing. They practice a lot, and you know, we haven't done much in the past, so we need to work on our drafting, or not drafting, sorry, our, you know, just like synergy as a team and, you know, decision making and stuff, because, you know, it's really important. So, you know, we're glad we're advancing, but I feel like we need to put in like a lot of work as well. So,
yeah. Is there, are there any teams out there specifically that do worry you a little bit, or is it just, you know?
I feel like, you know, anybody can almost beat anybody nowadays, so every team really is something to be, you know, concerned about. So, you know, Complexity probably the favorite of, you know, their recent results, and Fnatic, you know, not really being going to be a part of this anymore. So I'd say Complexity maybe.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Joe, do you have any questions?
I really don't. GG, well played with that roaming bubbles. Decent, as you would say.
Next level.
You know, we wanted to save it for DreamHack, but we had decided to bust it out. So.
You decided to bust it out for a 15-minute victory. It shows the power right here. I mean, now everyone's going to be banning bubbles against you guys. So
yeah.
You already accomplished that, I guess. No, definitely it was a lot of fun to watch. And again, like you said, maybe even it ended a little bit quicker than even we expected. Sounds like you expected, but hey, you got the win. That's what matters. So again, a big congratulations for that. Once again, any more shout-outs you want to make, Urizer?
Someone told me I have to give not really a shout-out, but I have to call out Dark Wonix because he wanted to play me in chess. But, he's dodging me right now. So, just, you know, Dark Wonix, if you're out there, bud, let's go. I'm ready.
Chess match for the
ages.
Body is ready.
Do what?
I said chess match for the ages.
Yeah.
We'll probably cast that if you guys make it happen. So just let us know. Just let us know. Not right. Really. We won't. But good luck with that.
Okay.
All right, man. I appreciate you coming on again. Big congratulations, and we'll see you next time, man.
Thanks. See ya.
All right. So there we are, joined by Riser from TT Esports, of course, coming on to talk about the how the game went. And, you know, again, it's not just like he put it at the very beginning there. It's like, so did the match go as expected? No, not really. We didn't think it was going to be that easy even.
Yeah.
So, and I agree with him. I mean, we were both stressing that throughout the series. It's unfortunate for FYKU that they weren't able to put up even more of a fight, especially in game number two. But let's just tell them dice roll, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's easy to say that, especially after that game we just watched where they really dominated from start to finish.
Mm-hmm.
But there were some scary points there in the first game. Like I said, I really think that FYKU were in a better position before it kind of crumbled there in the middle of the game. But unfortunately, for FYKU's sake, I think the morale got the best of them and weren't able to produce in the second game. But congrats to TT Esports, and they are looking in a good position for this group stage now.
Yeah. So on that note, guys, again, quick series. Unfortunately, that does mean a little bit quicker of a cast today. But definitely coming back at you, of course, tomorrow. Real quickly, though, we do want to give one more shout-out to there's an event that is actually starting. I believe it's actually coming up this weekend even. It's the Trench Warfare Tournament. It's actually the Mid-Wars Tournament that's going on here. I believe it's sponsored by Beyond Gaming and somebody else. I actually wanted to make sure that I get the right name for that. But anyways, it is Logitech and Beyond Gaming. So they're sponsoring the Mid-Wars Tournament. There's, as Phil actually said when he was on, I mean, there's actually a good amount of prizes. It's $400 for first, $250 for second, $150 for third as far as dollar-wise, but there's also some sweet gear that you get. Headsets, keyboard, mice, very, very nice. So this is a this is a Mid-Wars tournament, though. I mean, this is a more of a fun style of event, of course, but anyone can sign up, and honestly, anyone can be in Mid-Wars, let's be honest. That's just the type of game mode it is. So definitely go over to, I believe it's at beyondgaming.com/competition, and you can actually check it out there and even sign up for it. Chance to compete in some Mid-Wars, so maybe Tralf and I will enter. We'll see. You know, maybe we'll form a team.
You don't have to be the most competitive player to play Mid-Wars. I mean, anyone can beat anyone in that mode. It's a lot of fun. I don't want to say it's not taken too seriously, because I've played some Mid-War games where people take it way too seriously. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, it's a lot of fun. Go sign up for that.
Yeah, so on that note, too, we actually do have a couple of score updates that also happened, the matches that took place today. The first one being, now this is a Group B matchup. It was rescheduled to today. Complexity did beat Impunity. So I believe that knocks out Impunity of Group B, unfortunately for them. But they beat them 2-0. I believe that they won the first game, and then the second game was actually forfeited by Impunity even. So a little bit unfortunate there. But they took that series 2-0. Cats versus Call It Karma, they're actually in Game 3 right now. They're tied at one game apiece. So that's, again, they're at the bottom of Group C. Not the most impactful match in the sense of standing-wise, but still, you know, they're in a Game 3 there. So looking forward to see how Call It Karma and Cats Gaming finishes off with them too. And then one more is actually Vitriolic is actually defeating Team GA 1-0 currently. So, again, Vitriolic on.